Welcome to Your Voice, a program for you to see how your budget concerns are being heard in the New York State Senate with Senator Joe Griffo. I'm Julia Lokendy. Hi, Senator.
Julia, how are you?
Good. How are you doing?
I'm very good.
Since you've been here last, the budget has been passed. Why did you support it?
Well, the budget is $138 billion, and on balance is what you look at here, because there are parts of the budget that I did not agree with, but there were more parts that I agree with. And in the end, to have a fourth year in a row, which I think is very important that we were able to meet the deadline, because that is our responsibility, to have an on-time budget and to have a balanced budget and to live within the 2% spending cap, which I think is very important because we've imposed that upon local governments. So it's imperative that we lead by example. So all that was accomplished, and there were a number of elements in the budget that I think are important, which we'll talk about. So that's why overall I supported the budget. As I said, you have to look at a document like this as a document of compromise, and in the end, is it balanced?
Right. So tax reform, that was a big thing this year. Tell us what is in the budget.
Well, we, for a long time in the Senate, have been advocating for tax relief because we recognize that the major burdens on our local governments and businesses are the regulations and the mandates, the high taxes, and the high cost of utilities. So we wanted to deal with that. And in this particular budget, we see significant tax reform and relief, which is imperative if we're going to move the state forward. And it provides tax relief for families. It provides more opportunities for middle-class families as well as for elderly who are struggling right now. We're going to see a phasing out of the energy tax credit, which unfortunately was put in last year on both businesses and homeowners. So there will be an earned income tax credit for manufacturers. When we look at the business sector of our economy, manufacturing was targeted, and we're going to do some things there that are going to be very beneficial, hopefully, to those individuals who are involved in that industry. And so if you look at it from direct tax relief for individuals through various programs, through the fully funding STAR and the enhanced STAR program, for the earned incomes tax credit, for bringing New York in line with the feds on the estate tax. There are a number of, and there's some modifications that are going to have to be made there as a result of, you know, further homework as we saw the budget unfold and eventually be adopted. So ultimately, from a taxing perspective, we held the line on spending, stayed within the cap, and then you see a number of initiatives that were targeted towards reducing taxes and that burden on both homeowners and businesses.
All right, talk for a minute about how controlling spending impacts the taxpayer.
Well, very significantly, because in the past we'd see high growth of spending here. There are a lot of worthy projects and endeavors that we are involved with. But when you look at the state budget from the driving cost and the major cost factors of our budget, our education, health care, and general operations of the state. So when you look at that, it makes it very difficult. And at times when we had the challenges that we were facing and the deficits, there were some tough decisions made which negatively impacted many segments of our economy. So now that we are in a situation where we are stabilizing and attempting to grow, we want to create opportunity. So in order to do that, if you can hold the line on spending, and we've said this for a long time, that will enable you to reprioritize where you spend and also to grow the economy. So we still have a long way to go, but this is a step in the right direction. I know education funding was very important this year.
Yeah.
And this year we saw significant increases in education. Over $1.1 billion was added to education this year. We believed that we needed to reduce the GEA, which is something that was put in place during those difficult years when there were financial challenges. And we didn't agree with that, voted against it, but it was put in place. So we asked all of the educators across the state to tell us what their priority was. And the majority said eliminate that GEA. So this year we put over $600 million towards reduction of it. There's still over $1 billion that's left. Hopefully we can accelerate the elimination of this GEA construct. Beyond that, there's $25 billion in total education. There will be money for pre-K with some flexibility. There were issues that were put in there relative to the Common Core this year, because that has been something that parents, teachers, administrators have all discussed. We all agree with higher standards and establishing higher standards and even some continuity of standards, but I think the rollout here was a problem, and some of the elements that currently exist are continuing to present challenges and cause contention in many of the school districts. Mm-hmm. So what we tried to do here, we had hoped the Board of Regents would take action. They did not, so we acted, or they did not do something significant from our perspective and substantively. So the Senate guarded against student information and privacy. We wanted to ensure in the legislature that we took measures that assured and protected the privacy of the student, and the family should have that jurisdictional responsibility to determine what's best for the student.
Yeah.
Beyond that, we looked at testing, and there will be some changes in how the testing will be used for monitoring and evaluating performance, because we want to avoid having teachers teach to take a test. We want to truly measure intellectual aptitude and educational capacity. So that part was dealt with. There are still remaining things to be discussed, such as how the teachers play a part into that with the teacher evaluation system. I do believe we need to look at that. So all of that is very important. We also did some things in higher ed. We increased TAP. We increased the base foundation aid for community colleges. In healthcare, we expanded Epic to help seniors who really need that drug coverage, and I think that's very important. We also, in agriculture, continue to restore some of the cuts the governor had made and to make sure that we're paying attention to what's needed for our farmers and the agribusiness industry that's so important across the state. In transportation, the CHIPS money, the Consolidated Highway Program money, was continued at the same level last year, where we put a historic high last year of $75 million. We added a special $40 million pot because of the severe winter conditions this year. Mm-hmm. So that $40 million will follow the CHIPS formula, but will be for potholes, basically. And also, we tried to end a dysfunction here in Albany by not only getting an on-time budget, but dealing with some of the issues the ethical challenges that have presented itself here to some of these members of the legislature. So there's some new ethics initiatives and fighting crime and corruption in government.
Right.
So overall, I think we had a pretty good package.
I love my park days this weekend. So what about for the environment?
Well, the environment, very important. State parks are an important part of our economy. So we did a lot of good things in the environment, too. The EPF was kept at $162 million, which is the highest since 2008. And we looked at more money for water projects, improving state parks and historic sites. So I think there's a lot in there that will be, on balance, again, as I indicated earlier, beneficial to residents as a whole.
Another important topic, the heroin addiction epidemic. You hosted a forum in your district. What did you learn?
We're pleased to have Chairman Boyle, who chairs the task force on alcohol and substance abuse. It's a very serious issue. It's a scourge in our society. We know it does not discriminate. I thought we had a very emotional meeting where we not only had some of the individuals involved in the various disciplines, from law enforcement, from rehabilitation services, from poison control, but also from addicts themselves, talking about what it has meant to them and what it has done to their lives. So I think overall, the takeaway is that there needs to be more agency coordination and communication. There has to be some tougher laws put into place. We also have to do more in the terms of treatment and helping those individuals who are seeking treatment. This is, it was very emotional, as I indicated earlier, to listen to the individuals who have gone through this. And we've done some successful things with the iStop program. As a result of that, heroin now is cheaper, more available. So I think we have to look at this just the way we configured the panel, from all those areas, from law enforcement, from counseling and rehab treatment services, from education, how we educate people at a young age. So all of this together, I'm looking forward now that we are back in Albany to determine what legislation will be necessary, what additional resources will be necessary in order to help our communities fight this scourge.
Right. And this task force, you're going across the state.
It's gone across the state. I'm pleased to be a member of the task force, and I'm hopeful that we'll have something positive and beneficial as a result of this for all of our communities.
Yeah, it's really crazy how it's snowballed. And when people do finally decide that they need help, a lot of times they're turned away.
Correct.
Yeah. Thank you so much for being with us, Senator.
My pleasure.
If you would like more information on the heroin epidemic, the budget, and other decisions being made in the Senate, Griffo.mysenate.gov.